Hi, my name is Julie and I'm a part of the family of St Andrew's Church. And I'm also a part of the family of Emmanuel Community Church, who meet at Radcliffe Primary School. And some of us from Emmanuel Community have been invited on a big church weekend at the end of July, which we're really looking forward to. There's going to be some speakers, there's a live band, and we've got trips out, and it should be really good fun. And Joe and I wondered if some of you guys at St Andrew's Church might like to help towards the funding of this weekend. So maybe you might like to give a small financial donation towards the weekend and what we do at Emmanuel. Or you might like to give something physical, like some bottles of water or some crisps or some biscuits or cakes or cans of pop that we could take with us and help people with the costs. So if you'd like to give something towards the weekend, Joe's going to have a collection after the 10:30 service on the 18th of July. And whatever anybody brings, she's going to put on one side for us. And I just also would like to say thank you to everybody who has faithfully prayed for Emmanuel Community. God is really blessing everything that we do, and it's so exciting to see what God is doing in that. So thank you again for your prayers, and thank you for anybody who would like to donate towards our weekend away and the work that we do. So thank you. See you soon. Bye.
Our service of this morning. Welcome to everyone in the building. Welcome to you online. It's great that we can join together, whether together or at home. We've just had that video by Julie, and so today after the service, for those of you that are in the building, you've got your normal brown envelopes for envelope giving or for cash donations. If you leave those on your seats, that's great. And as you go out, if you would like to give anything towards the Emmanuel Community, there's a blue bucket at the back, and donations can be given there. Or if you've got food donations, you can leave them on the table. For those of you that are at home and you would like to give something, then please do pop on by the church and give in whatever you would like. We're going to be here until 12 o'clock. So just a huge thank you from myself and Julie for supporting the new members of the church plant on the Coronation Estate. I'm going to do a few notices now and a few notices later, just because we have quite a few notices this week. So if you've watched the news at all this week, you will know that tomorrow there is an opening up of COVID restrictions. And this week, the PCC has been working hard on our approach to releasing the restrictions here in church. And so it has been decided that we will open up with caution and only release measures slowly. So in the next week, the changes that will come into place is that no booking is required for any of our services. So at the moment, we require a 9:15 booking and a communion booking. We no longer will need those booking systems. As of next week, we will be allowed to sing in the building. Woohoo! And those of you that are online, that will stay the same. But for us in the building, that will be quite a step in a different direction. And I'm sure that we will appreciate that. However, we are going to ask people to keep their masks on for singing and for coming into the building. And I know that's going to be hard, but just so that we can keep keeping ourselves as safe as we can at the moment, and particularly as we are in quite a high area of COVID transmissions, I think that would be a good thing for us to do. Also, we are not getting rid of social distancing from one another. We are going to bring it to 1 meter distancing between people, and we're also going to provide an area, a small area, for those that would like to continue at 2 metre distancing and to have that option too. So you'll just need to let us know that you'd like to be in that area when you come in. So what remains the same is that we'll wear our masks in, we'll sanitise our hands. The one-way system will stay in place just so that we can cater for that 1 metre social distancing, and the guiding to the seats will continue. And not yet, but will be coming soon, will be refreshments. I think probably refreshments will come as of September once we figure out how that's going to work safely. There will be refreshments available on the two Sundays that we're having conversations after the service, but we'll be able to bring refreshments to you in your places. And not yet also is receiving the wine from one cup. So today we're still under restrictions, but we won't be having the cup in August. We're going to be continuing to review that as a PCC. And then finally, not yet, physical contact, such as handshaking, hugging and kissing. If we can refrain from doing that for the time being, that would be really, really helpful. So those are just the COVID, so that you know the way in which the PCC have been reviewing and thinking about the restrictions this week. And so all of those restrictions are going to be under current review, and so that we can do it in a gentle and safe way. So let's now take a moment of quiet as we prepare ourselves to come before God, who is almighty, who is with us and longs for us to meet with him. So let's have a moment of quiet.
Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Karen, and I'm a member of the church family here at St Andrews. Most of you know me. If you're new to St Andrews, either here in the building or online at home, we really wish you welcome. Joe's already greeted you so beautifully anyway. All the words you need for this service will be on the screen. So we meet in the name of God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We're going to come now to a time of confession and absolution. But after we confess our sins to God, and before we are absolved of them, comes the important middle part. In Hebrew, the word is shuv. It literally means change direction. And as we change direction from walking the path that we walk, that may be away from Christ, we turn and we look once more into the face of Jesus. And as we recognize him, like those on the Emmaus path that we'll hear of later, as we recognize him, as we turn to face him, he changes our hearts and our minds and gives us the peace that only he can give. Holy, holy, holy. When our eyes have seen the Lord of hosts, we echo the words of Isaiah. Woe is me, I am doomed. We long for the fire of God's cleansing to touch our unclean lips, for our iniquity to be removed and our sins wiped out. So we meet Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with confession on our lips. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. renew a right spirit within us, and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us to his image, to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, as loved and cleansed, forgiven children of God, let's join together in our first song. So as Joe said, at home you can sing your hearts out, but here for just one more week, please stand as you're able and hum behind your masks. The beautiful in Christ alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live.
Truly comforting words. Nothing can pluck us from his hand. During the pandemic and the lockdown, Bill and I have taken part in many of the wonderful Tuesday evening sessions that Joe has been leading, but not this current series, and I believe that this is the final week looking at his story. We're going to hear now from Stephen Cottrell, the Archbishop of York, about his faith journey. And after that, we'll be hearing the Word of God from Elizabeth, and Joe will bring us our sermon.
I wasn't brought up in a church family. I was baptised as a baby, so I did make at least one visit to church in my childhood. But the short version of the rather long story for me, I think, starts first of all with the thinking that I think I always believed in God. And I kind of always want to hang on to that I think so many people, especially children, have a really strong sense of God. I don't know where it came from particularly. I just remember believing in God and having some dreams about God as a child. And so that was always deep inside me, the sense that there is a God, but unformed. Then my sister joined the Girl Guides, which is my younger sister. So she'd have been about 10 or 11 at the time. I'd have been 12 or 13, I suppose. She joined the Girl Guides. And she was required to go to a church parade service once a month. She and a small group of friends liked what they found at the church parade service and so started going along on the other Sundays in between and got confirmed. My parents were part of the great post-war lapsed generation who hadn't rejected the Christian faith, they'd just gotten out the habit. They returned to church through my sister. And eventually I gave church a try. Now, my Auntie Millie was a devout Roman Catholic. Went to Mass every day of her life. When I was ordained as a deacon, she came to my ordination service. And at the bum fight after the ordination, she told me that every day of her life when she'd been to Mass, she had prayed for the conversion of my family. Wow. Because we none of us were church people. And when she told me that somebody had been praying for me every day of my life, I suddenly saw my whole story in a new way and thought, you know, I thought I'd become a Christian because of decisions I'd made. I had decided to do this and I decided to follow that. And yet here was another person that had been woven into my story who I never knew. She simply prayed for me and for my family. As I've often reflected on my own story, I realized that how God has woven into my story the witness of so many other people who all played their part. You know,
today's reading is taken from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart. to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. Thank you.
Well, today is the last sermon in our Living His Story series. And we have been thinking about stories as a means of telling others about Jesus. Stories are powerful. Stories are part of our day-to-day experience. And I wonder how many of us have been following the stories of the England team this week. The stories of their abuse has been heartbreaking. And in years to come, the story of that match will be one of determination, loss, abuse, outrage, and compassion. Well, our story today from Luke's Gospel is of two travellers who have a story to tell. A story of an amazing man who did miraculous things but died a gruesome death. The injustice of it and the fear of what remains. Here we have an eyewitness account of two disciples walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus on that first Easter Sunday, the third day after Jesus' death. And some people think that the distance between Jerusalem and Emmaus is about 7 miles, so probably about a 3 or 4 hour walk at a good pace. Luke tells us that one of the walkers is Cleopas, but the identity of the other person is not revealed, so probably isn't that important. So we hear that it is in the late afternoon when Cleopas and the other traveller decide to leave Jerusalem to go to Emmaus. They've heard the news that Jesus' grave was empty from the women, and that they had seen an angel who had told them that Jesus is alive. Still, though, they were sad. Their eyes were downcast. Their emotions were filled with hopelessness. So let us journey with them through this story again and experience their story. Well, they were walking along a familiar road, the road that they have travelled only a week before. And as they walked, they talked about the strange events that they had seen. "Do you remember how they welcomed him?" said Cleopas. "Oh yes, they were waving palm branches and cheering," answered the other sadly. "He taught such wonderful things in the temple," Cleopas sighed. "I thought everyone loved him," replied the other traveller.
Everyone but the religious leaders, whispered Cleopas. They've been plotting against him for a long time. And now he's gone, they said together. They walked on, whispering sadly. Their hope had gone. Jesus, their hope of being the Messiah to Israel, had gone. They had been wrong. How had they misunderstood the scriptures of old? They had come from the gathering where the women had told them that Jesus was alive, but they couldn't believe what they had heard. They couldn't have believed what the women had said. Who would? They were only women, after all. Then, hello, said a stranger. Why are you looking so sad? A terrible thing's happened in Jerusalem, said the traveller, to this apparently ignorant stranger. Our friend Jesus was killed on a cross, and we thought he was the Messiah, God's chosen one. And now we are confused and sad, added Cleopas. Yes, I know what happened, said the stranger rebukingly. But don't you understand? The prophets spoke about all these things, and now they've come true. The tables were turned. The stranger began to highlight their ignorance as he started to explain how the prophets and the long-told story of God's plan long ago. And this stranger interpreted to them all the scriptures through the Bible that pointed to Jesus. Not just a few scriptures or a dozen isolated texts chosen at random. No, the whole story from Genesis to Chronicles. They listened in amazement to all he had to say. This stranger pointed to the fulfillment which could only be found when God's appointed long took Israel's suffering. And very soon they were in the village of Emmaus, and the stranger started to say goodbye. Like so many times before, they naturally invited the stranger to stay with them, for hospitality towards a stranger ranked highly as a religious and cultural value, because you never know when you might be unknowingly entertaining angels. But today they also wanted to hear more. Stay and eat with us. It's late. You must be hungry, they said. Thank you, said the stranger, and soon they were sitting at the table to eat. The table was laid with bread, cheese, fruit, and wine. And then the stranger, even though he was a guest, took it upon himself to host the meal. He took the bread and blessed it. And in the breaking of the bread, it was almost like the breaking of Satan's power to blind people that had kept the two travellers from seeing who this stranger was. This was broken. And suddenly Cleopas and the other traveller recognised the stranger. It was no stranger. It was Jesus. Jesus was with them again. They looked at one another. They looked at Jesus, but he had vanished. Then they understood more of what the prophets had foretold. They had been blind in seeing how God would save his people. They had been watching for how the Messiah would redeem Israel from suffering. But through the revealing of Jesus as the stranger, their eyes were open to see that Jesus would redeem Israel through suffering. Suffering which would be taken on by Jesus himself as Israel's representative, the Messiah. They also then understood the stories they had heard earlier, the stories from the women. Jesus is alive! Jesus is alive! They shouted together, and without even eating one bite. They left their home and ran all the way back to Jerusalem to tell the others what they had seen. Well, like these two travellers on the road to Emmaus, we are all on a journey of faith. And this journey of faith will be full of stories, stories like we've had just retold. We will have stories of when life is good. We will also have stories of when life isn't easy, isn't straightforward. But we will have stories that point to Jesus being with us in the highs and the lows. A lot of the time, like the two men on the road to Emmaus, we don't always see God's big plan, as only the big picture is known to him. And in my experience, he works on a need-to-know basis. One of the things that we can learn from this story is that Jesus connects with the travellers. He knows their story even before they've told it, but he lets them speak. He listens, and then he tells them his story. His story in this case was being present from the beginning of creation and retelling the story, helped them to join up the dots to make sense of their own story. A bit like in the video with Stephen Cottrell, having come to faith and knowing who had prayed for him and seeing his journey of faith, seeing those witnesses and those stories that make up the bigger story. We, in our conversations with people, can listen to where they are at and offer our stories in finding Jesus. Finding Jesus as a child through school, maybe. Finding Jesus in difficult circumstances. Finding Jesus through having a child, or indeed through childlessness. We all have a story, and God calls us to use our stories to share our experiences of him as a perfect father, as a savior, as a guide. God did not design us to travel this life alone. He made a way for us to have him as our living, traveling guide, to partner with us so that we may never need be alone, through the sending, the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwells in us, journeys with us, equips us, and tells our God, enables us to tell our God stories to others. Let us be intentional in wanting to tell others about our amazing God and how amazing he is to us. Let us not have our eyes downcast like the two travellers in the story did. Let us be looking for those opportunities to share with others the goodness, the grace, and mercy of Jesus. And we can do that by sharing our own stories of how good God has been to us. So in this week, I invite you to think about the ways in which you have experienced God's goodness to you. How has he met you in difficult times? Remember when you've been struck in awe at creation, or indeed the immensity of the significance of Jesus' death and resurrection. How has he provided for you? What are the miraculous things that he has done? Write them down. Recognize what God has done and pray that he will give you the opportunity to tell these stories at God-appointed times for his glory and for his honor. So let us pray. Creator God, open our eyes to see all that you have done for us and all that you are doing for us. We pray that you would give us opportunities to share our God stories with others. As we do, may every breath be taken for your glory. May every footstep show you as our way. But trusting in your presence in this world, we may beyond this life still be with you wherever you are alive and reign forever and ever. Amen. And so continuing in an attitude of prayer, praying for others, that the world, that the church, for those who we know are sick and suffering, that they may know something of God being with them. Let us pray.
Good morning. Let us pray. Gracious God, fountain of all wisdom, we pray for all Christian people. And we pray for our church leadership team. And we pray for Bob and Joe and all the other leaders. We pray for our deanery. And we pray for our diocese. And we pray for our bishops, David, Mark and Mark. We pray for those who teach and guard the faith. May the word of Christ dwell richly in our hearts and knit us together in the bond of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the leaders of this nation and for those in authority under them. Give them the gift of your wisdom and a right discernment in all things, and to make the right decisions that benefit each and every one of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father God, we pray for Radcliffe, for those who live and work here in Radcliffe, and for those who visit. Speak your word of peace and love in our midst, and help us serve one another as Christ has served us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for those who do not believe and yet long to know you, the very word of life. Open their ears to hear your voice and open their hearts to the knowledge of your love in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for those who are sick, those who are sick in mind, body and spirit. May your living word bring them comfort and healing. And we raise before you the names on our lips and in our hearts. And we take a moment to rise these before you, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father God, we pray for those who are bowed down with grief, for those who are bereaved, for those who are missing a loved one. We pray, Lord, that they receive your unearthly peace and your comfort, and any anger they have, Lord, please turn it into firmer hope in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, Father God, we pray for ourselves. We pray that you guide us to give us the conversations that we need to spread your word. Strengthen us, good Lord, to live in your way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Most merciful God, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Craig, for those beautiful prayers, and Joe for your word, and Elizabeth for the reading. May the Lord God give us understanding. I was quite profoundly moved by what Archbishop Stephen said about his auntie. And prayer is such a powerful thing. I think we underestimate it at our peril. And a few years ago, a little story from me here. A few years ago, Joe gave us all a little leather string. I don't know whether you all remember that we tied knots in. And I use that every day and still use it every day as part of my own prayers. I pray for my family. I pray for different situations. But as Joe's often encouraging us to do, I pray for individuals that I want to come to faith. And yesterday I realised that I've been praying for this one particular person for 10 years. So I prayed for him every day for 10 years. And just hearing that story of Archbishop Stephen's just really encouraged me, because we don't know what God's doing, but he does. So if we faithfully pray for people, for people's lives, then he will bring about his purposes and plans. All we need to do is obey, really. So, and we're going to come to another prayer now, and this is our offering prayer. So there's lots of different ways that we can offer. You know, we can cash in the envelopes on the church pews, by card, and somebody at the back will have a card machine, or also, obviously, by direct debit. Oh, I believe it, everyone's pointing at each other. One of them, I think it's Sally, will have the card machine at the back at the end. But also, you know, it's really, really important that we give financially, and I think it's wonderful to support Emmanuel Community Church as well as our own mission and work here at St Andrew's. But it isn't just about our financial giving. It is about giving our whole lives as an offering of worship to God. So let us just bow our heads for a moment and do that. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Of your own we give back to you. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Amen. And now let us once more affirm our faith in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit as we join in song. Please stand as you're able. Hum to your heart's content, sing your hearts, open the window. I open the window at home so my neighbours can hear as we sing This I Believe.
Our Father everlasting, the all creating one, God Almighty. Spirit conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again.
Resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name. Please be seated. And so, peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, peace from his Son, Jesus Christ, who is our peace, peace from the Holy Spirit, the life giver, the peace of the triune God, be always with you and also with you. So as we approach communion this morning, we are going to be bringing the bread to you in your seats. If you can put your hands outstretched far out, that would be really helpful and also quite cupped so that we can place the bread into your hands easily. And during our time of communion, let us pray for that one or two people that you long to come to know Jesus. Pray for those opportunities. Maybe ask God to remind you of those stories of times in which he has provided, that he has brought about transformation. So the Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. So, Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you, with the saints and angels praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. So we praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends. And taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine, and again he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. So, Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and your justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us into your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. So, looking for the coming of his kingdom, as our Saviour taught us, So we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord, we died with you on the cross. Now we are raised to new life. We were buried in your tomb. Now we share in your resurrection. Live in us, that we may live in you. The body and blood of Christ keep us in eternal life. Amen.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread. Savior Jesus Christ torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. Around the table, love.
So, Almighty and Eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory, who are three persons, yet one God, now and forever. Amen. And so we've come to more notices. More notices. There's like notice fest today. So just again about Emmanuel Community and financial gifts and food for them to take on their camping trip next week from after this service until 12 o'clock. Last Monday evening at the PCC, we had a good discussion about the installation of an accessible toilet and the renewal of the kitchen. Next Sunday, after the 10:30 service, there will be an opportunity for people to come into the building and to talk about this project, to express your ideas, your views, your concerns, if you got the email this week about filling in a survey, my apologies, because it did say the 15th of July and it should have said 15th of August. And when I went on to correct it, it then created another option. So I'm apologies for that survey. So if you've got completely confused, I'm really sorry. But do come and see us either next Sunday or Sunday the 15th of August. And we will have another opportunity to talk about the various questions and views that people have on this. Also to say about those conversations next week, if you want to bring a packed lunch with you, please do, because we will be able to eat our own lunch together. If you'd like to eat with people, then bring your own packed lunch and we will provide tables and a little bit of distance between you on those tables, but you'll be able to connect with one another in a way that we haven't been able to connect over the last 18 months. The next graveyard tidy up after the really successful one of last week, was it the week before, is going to be on Saturday the 7th of August, 9:30 to 12. And this tidy up will focus on the wall around the church. So we focus this time on around the building itself, and this time we're going to go around the wall and tidy up. Bev and Amelia did an amazing job of picking up three bags of litter. We'll need to do a litter pick today on that day again, and also we'll need to weed the Garden of Remembrance and the War Memorial. Sheila, you did an amazing job on that War Memorial, so thank you. We'll keep it under control. So please do join us, and hopefully it won't rain like last time. Please do read the church update email, as there are going to be details about the August events that we're planning to have in August, so that it gives us time to spend with one another. We're going to have a quiz night with a chippy tea. We're going to have an afternoon tea, which is going to be raising funds towards Emmanuel Community. The Ark Band are going to do a worship evening towards the end of August. And I love that. There's a big round of applause in the building for those of you online that can't hear it. And there's, as I've said, a graveyard TLC morning. So please do read the church update email. Please do fill in the survey if you can. We really want to hear your thoughts and for you to have your say. Just also then, lastly to say, during August, we're going to be rearranging the pews, and that's in part because we're going to have a look at the flooring, and by moving them forward, we can also have a good look at what's going on down there. And just wanted to let you know, just so that none of you are taken by surprise. Birthdays. Oh, he's not here to remind me. Anyway, I looked for him there, so I noticed that he was missing. So this past week, it's been Matthew
Graham's 40th birthday, and this week coming is Brian Samuel's birthday, Eileen Middlefell, and Craig Holden. Eileen and Craig's birthday is actually next Sunday. So happy birthday to all of you, and hope you have a good birthday. And in terms of wedding anniversary, Joyce and Alan, who are in the building this morning, this week is your 58th wedding anniversary. Congratulations. Absolutely fantastic. So we're going to stand, if you're in the building, stand and hum very loudly. And if you're at home, sing your hearts out with the amazing truth of how great thou art.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider thy hand hath made. I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul,
my soul, my Savior God.
Just have to compose myself. What an amazing sending out hymn. It took every ounce of my self-control not to sing to that. So I wish you all the most blessed of weeks, and that you truly are sent out to be able to turn your face towards the Lord and do his will. And now the Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the holy and undivided Trinity, guard us, save us, and bring us to that heavenly city where he lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Hi, my name is Julie and I'm a part of the family of St Andrew's Church. And I'm also a part of the family of Emmanuel Community Church, who meets at Radcliffe Primary School. And some of us from Emmanuel Community have been invited on a big church weekend at the end of July, which we're really looking forward to. There's going to be some speakers, there's a live band, and we've got trips out, and it should be really good fun. And Joe and I wondered if some of you guys at St Andrew's Church might like to help towards the funding of this weekend. So maybe you might like to give a small financial donation towards the weekend and what we do at Emmanuel. Or you might like to give something physical, like some bottles of water or some crisps or some biscuits or cakes or cans of pop that we could take with us and help people with the costs. So if you'd like to give something towards the weekend, Joe's going to have a collection after the 10:30 service on the 18th of July. And whatever anybody brings, she's going to put on one side for us. And I just also would like to say thank you to everybody who has faithfully prayed for Emmanuel Community. God is really blessing everything that we do, and it's so exciting to see what God is doing in that. So thank you again for your prayers, and thank you for anybody who would like to donate towards our weekend away and the work that we do. So thank you. See you soon. Bye.